Penguin Random House Audio presents Burn Rate, Launching a Startup and Losing My Mind. This is the author, Andy Dunn. For Usha, Monica, and Charlie, without you, I have no past. For Manuela, without you, I have no present. For Isaiah, and for Bella, without you, I have no future. Author's note. This book isn't what you think it is. It is not a self-aggrandizing tale of entrepreneurial success. It is not an insider's guide to launching a startup, brimming with insights packaged for tech bros or corporate leaders looking for an edge. This book is a ghost story. My ghost first arrived in the year 2000 and would haunt me for the next 16 years. It was a secret known only to a handful of my closest loved ones. My ghost is an illness, one that can amplify human potential and seek to destroy it at the same time. For some, a ghost like mine might even seem life-expanding, jet fuel for the entrepreneurial drive, before the liabilities rip it all apart. Here's the tabloid-ready summary of my book. In 2016, on the precipice of selling Bonobos, the startup I'd been building for the previous 9 years, I flew into a manic spiral and was hospitalized for a week in the psych ward at Bellevue in New York. When I was discharged, I was met by NYPD officers who took me to jail where I was charged with felony and misdemeanor assault. Thanks to my ghost, I came within an inch of losing the woman who is now my wife, the company, and everything I cared for in the world. Here's the thing, I still live with it, but the ghost, my diagnosis of bipolar disorder, isn't a secret anymore. It has taken 5 years of therapy to be able to write those words. Normally, when your most shameful life events have been hidden behind a veil of secrecy, you keep them under the rug or in the closet, unexcavated. But what if there is nothing to be ashamed of? Then why would they need to be secrets at all? If there was not a profound stigma around mental illness, this book would not be necessary. Perhaps it could make a good startup yarn about the time a couple of guys hit the e-commerce moment right, despite a lot of bad ideas along the way. The truth, though, is that the stigma is here, and it is profound. Mental illness is one of the final taboos. The business community values stability when it comes to leading teams, shepherding capital, and governing enterprises. A steady hand is what is sought. So even as we've entered a new era, one where assumptions surrounding race, gender, and power are being interrogated more deeply, issues of mental illness in the workplace go largely unmentioned. For most of my professional life, my mental illness has felt unspeakable, a fast track to an awkward silence, a closed door, or a lost opportunity. The thing is, a lot of us have it. A lot. The illness I deal with, bipolar disorder, affects 3% of the population, and by one estimate, is 7 times more prevalent in entrepreneurs. That might mean 20% of entrepreneurs have bipolar disorder. It is an illness where suicide attempt rates approach 60%, and suicide success rates approach 20%. One study by the National Institutes of Health indicated that almost half of entrepreneurs deal with mental health issues. The figure was 32% for non-entrepreneurs, staggering in its own right. In the world of sports, the mental health conversation is beginning, thanks to Naomi Osaka, Simone Biles, Marty Fish, and many others. In entertainment, it's understood and accepted that artists face mental health challenges. Witness Kanye West, Demi Lovato, and Britney Spears. In the business world, though, no one talks. I'm lucky to be in a position where I have a voice. My exited startup good fortune insulates me from the fear of financial loss, if not social stigma or personal embarrassment. So why go there? By not discussing what transpired, I would be letting the delusion continue to masquerade as fantasy. It never happened. It won't happen again. To see this ghost clearly, I needed to bring him out of the closet, to acknowledge the impact he has had on my life as a matter of public record. To deny this ghost is to deny myself. I write this memoir to surface the darker story, behind the airbrushed, living the dream bullshit. This is a book about mental illness told by an entrepreneur lucky to have made it to the other side, even if the other side is an impermanent place full of surprises. This book is my own story. My account is based on my own recollections, triangulated as much as possible with those of others, family members and friends and loved ones who were there for the ride. It's impossible that I got everything right. In chapters in which I depict an episode of full-blown mania, I switch the narration to the present tense to emphasize both the impulsive chaos of these experiences and the blurred nature of my memories of them. In some cases, I've chosen to alter names or identifying details, or only provide a first name, where I felt it wasn't important for readers to know a person's real identity, and where the imperfections of my memory would be a disservice to them. I write this for the families out there coping with the maddening, challenging people they desperately want to help. Let this be a reminder that there will be thanks later, that on the other side is unending gratitude for your sacrifices and for your love. Most of all, I write this for all of you struggling with a secret you feel you can't talk about. I hope this book serves as a reminder that there can be a path to health, integration, and healing. For me, it came in the form of a complex daily regimen of medication, therapy sessions multiple times a week with my psychiatrist, Dr. Z, a lawyer when I needed one, a sleep tracker and daily sleep report, the privilege to be able to afford it all, and the unbending, redemptive love and eventual clear-eyed determination and acceptance of a small band of family members and friends who rallied around me and who helped keep me sane. And who still do. Let me tell you a ghost story. Part 1. Origin of the Species. The Chinese believe that before you can conquer a beast, you must first make it beautiful. In some strange way, I have tried to do that with manic depressive illness. It has been a fascinating, albeit deadly, enemy and companion. I have found it to be seductively complicated, a distillation both of what is finest in our natures and of what is most dangerous. K. Redfield Jameson in Unquiet Mind. First the fall, and then the recovery from the fall, and both are the mercy of God. Julian of Norwich. Chapter 1. Windu. In Hindi, there are at least 10 words for aunt or uncle. Your mother's sister, mother's brother, father's sister, father's brother, mother's sister-in-law, mother's brother-in-law, and on and on. They all have different names. The most affectionate term of all is Masi, reserved for your mother's sister. For my sister and me, our mom's family was the strongest force in our childhood. Our mom has 4 sisters, so I have 4 Masis. It was a profoundly and proudly matriarchal upbringing. What I didn't know at the time was that I would one day spend 13 years building a company named for a species of matriarchal chimpanzee. Mom's parents, Prakash and Dhyan, were born in Rawalpindi, a city in Punjab state. In 1947, the British split Punjab in two, creating a Pakistani side and an Indian side. Muslims over here, Hindus over there. My grandparents, a Hindu and a Sikh, had to leave in the middle of the night with their 2 daughters. The region was thrown into chaos, with an estimated 15 million people displaced and at least 1 million killed. Usha Ahuja, my mother, was born in this context, in a refugee town called Kurukshetra, during her family's multi-year journey from Rawalpindi to New Delhi, where they eventually settled. My mom's mom, our birdie mummy, Prakash, was a child bride, not educated beyond the 6th grade. She lost 2 children in infancy before she turned 18. Then she had 7 kids, 5 girls and 2 boys. My mom and her sisters adored their father, and they feared him too. The level of his expectations for their success was daunting. He was an enterprising building contractor, a chain smoker, and an alcoholic. He instilled in his daughters a progressive message, ahead of its time in 1950s and 60s India. You don't want to be dependent on a man like me. His vision for his children was for them to get educated and make it to the United States. By the time he fell ill with emphysema, my mom had graduated college and had been shipped first to Canada and then to the United States to live with my Ashimasi.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.